Hey Chris, this is Robert Ian with ConquerChange.com. There has been a lot of discussion this week on the implications of the recent lawsuit settlement by Deutsche Bank over allegations it manipulated gold and silver prices. A Bloomberg article disclosed Deutsche Bank also agreed to help the plaintiffs in this matter pursue similar claims against other banks as part of the settlement. In addition, the bank will turn over instant messages and other communications to help further the plaintiff's case. So far, only Deutsche Bank has reached a settlement. Five other banks were also named in the lawsuit. This may grow legs and turn into something spectacular, like a tobacco-style settlement. But then again, it may not. The myth of no gold and silver manipulation is a fairy tale that can no longer be supported. This lawsuit and any negotiated legal settlement may ultimately be designed as window dressing to compartmentalize the idea of, yes, there was precious metals manipulation after all, but it's been rooted out, and now we can close that chapter and that line of thinking, and prevent a wider and more systemic discussion and investigation into, dare we say, organized price suppression on behalf of central banks and a strong dollar policy. I'd like to take you back in time to April of 2008 at the GATA Goes to Washington conference, where the late Adrian Douglas spoke on this very subject. From my April 2008 Goldseek commentary, I said, Adrian showed a chart that directly relates the introduction of the strong dollar policy to the severe downturn in gold from 1995 through 2001. He calls this Exhibit A in the gold price suppression scheme. According to the research done by several speakers at the GATA conference, the gold suppression scheme began during the Clinton administration in 1994 with Secretary of the Treasury Robert Rubin and his undefined strong dollar policy. That's some of the historical context of gold price suppression. At the bottom of the Bloomberg article, it actually provides the case number for the United States District Court, Southern District of New York. Downloading and reading 200-page lawsuits is something more people interested in this space should do. There are documents listed for both the silver litigation and gold litigation. This is really important stuff. Because for all the years this intervention has taken place, free markets, investments, companies, and people's lives have been delayed, shattered, and in some cases, ruined. There has been a massive misinformation campaign against anyone who has dared to educate the public about the facts of market manipulation. It exists. It has existed. It has required those with lateral thinking skills and unique analytical skills to forge ahead, despite the annoying conspiracy theorist rhetoric. Well, let me say this loud and clear. The conspiracy is no longer a theory. In fact, it never was. It is, was, and always has been a fact. The charts and graphs in these legal documents are quite educational and worth reading for anyone who has an interest in really delving into this matter and understanding it from an organic level. Back in 2008, I commented on how market manipulation negatively impacts technical analysis and makes markets counterintuitive. Let's say you're in a blackjack game and you know how to count cards. In other words, you know how to determine the probability that certain cards will be dealt as the game progresses. Call it a form of technical analysis. Counting cards doesn't mean you're going to win. It simply means you bet according to the probability of what might happen. It's an educated guess. Now let's say, unbeknownst to the players, the dealer in that game is cheating. He's doing false shuffles and occasionally dealing from the bottom of the deck. When you've got a dealer that is cheating, it renders your technical analysis obsolete. It makes the game counterintuitive. You start second-guessing yourself and the fundamentals, because you never know when the dealer is going to pull his next sleight of hand. But the good news is you eventually have to change dealers and/or the players, i.e. the investors, start to figure out something is terribly wrong. And isn't that what's happening in the market today? People are beginning to wake up and realize that all is not as it appears to be. And it's been a long road, with a lot of destruction, a lot of financial loss, and personal loss. It's not just the value of the gold and silver that was manipulated. It was people's lives and their destinies, their families, the cost of settling the losses and collateral damage of gold and silver price manipulation is gargantuan. I am reposting the videos of Bill Murphy from GATA in 2010 at the CFTC hearings that I posted on YouTube, where he originally unveiled details about gold price suppression and was met with what I will call suppression deniers from every corner. It's worth watching again to know what an unwavering advocate gold and silver have had with Bill Murphy and Chris Powell for so many years. Whatever comes of this Deutsche Bank settlement and any other negotiated settlements that result from it may be the only official resolution that comes into the public spotlight on the gold and silver suppression issue. And until next time, this is Robert Ian with ConquerChange.com, reminding you to follow us on Twitter at ConquerChange. Thanks, Chris.
Okay, Robert, thanks for another excellent installment. Well, that wraps up this week's GoldSeek.com radio episode. For two new big guests, be sure to check out next week's show. Until we talk to you again, have a great week.